Hi guys, welcome to another Dorm Room Review video. This is for the book of the year for 2016 on the Magic Cafe. It won book of the year, and it is the Jerx Volume 1 by Andy. It's a really nice cover. Let's just talk about that first of all. It's just all black, and then when you get it in the right light, you can see a little critter appearing in the corner, and that is a Jerx cat, I think. And then the Jerx is written on the side, and other than that, this is it. It does come with a little package of a bookmark and a page from a magazine, which is used in a couple of effects in the book. And it also comes with another book. And this other book is called The Amateur at the Kitchen Table. So let me just start by telling you, if you don't know anything about Andy and the Jerx blog, then you're missing out. Basically, there's a guy named Andy, at least that's his online pseudonym, and he writes a magic blog where he puts all of his ideas about presenting magic and really just anything magic related that he can come up with. But a large part of it is his thoughts on presenting magic in the amateur world. So his thoughts kind of revolve around the fact that spectators actually don't like the normal interaction between, and I'm talking about in a casual setting with friends and even strangers, but they don't like the relationship between them and the performer because the performer is genuinely, I was putting those two together, they are genuinely like, look at me, here's the cool thing I can do, and you are less than. And his whole performance philosophy is to bring them in and make them part of the magic and actually give them an experience rather than just performing to them. So The Amateur at the Kitchen Table is actually a book that is all about his presentation styles. I'm not going to get into them, but if you want to know anything about it without buying the Jerx Volume 1, you can go online to the Jerx blog. And you will absolutely be able to read a lot of his thoughts and presentation. And I have to say, I love his thoughts. And they've kind of revolutionized how I think about performing for friends and family and even strangers in a casual setting. So again, I really highly recommend it. A lot of his thoughts from the blog are put inside of this small book, at least the performance side of it. Some of them are just brilliant. Like, I'll just tell you, one of them is the whole idea that he calls it the distracted artist presentation. And the idea is that magic is just happening to you. So like, he was visiting with an artist friend of his, and as they were having a conversation, his friend was just drawing on a piece of paper and ended up with this beautiful illustration. And he was like, you know, why can't magicians do that too? So it's the whole idea behind it is you're having a conversation with someone, and you ask to see their new ring, and you look at it, and all of a sudden their ring's gone, and you're like, what the crap? And you're looking for it, and then you pull out your keys and set them on the table, and it's on your keychain, and you're like, ugh. So that's kind of the idea behind it. That's a watered down version, but the idea is that magic is happening to you, that you aren't doing the magic. That's just one of his ideas, of his many ideas on presentation. So this whole book covers that. And now we get into the Jerx Volume 1 itself. Some of the ideas in this book are on his blog for free. If you want to see some of the effects, go online to the Jerx blog and you can read some of the effects that I'm going to be telling you about here. So I'm actually just going to open it up and read the table of contents. By the way, it has a nice little pattern in the beginning, which I do enjoy. So let me get right into it. There is actually a 26-page essay on presentation inside of the Jerx blog itself. So actually all of this part of the book is notes on presentation. And again, it kind of mimics what is said in the Amateur at the Kitchen Table. It's just his basic thoughts about presenting in the casual setting. And then we get to the spectator cuts the aces three ways. And this is three different ways to do a spectator cutting the aces routine. He does have illustrations teaching you a very basic ace cutting routine in case you don't know any. And the first version is called the Ocean's 11 version, and essentially, I'm not going to get too in-depth here, but it's like a gambling demonstration. You're asking your friend for help, and it's really, really cool and quirky, and they will definitely leave remembering the experience that they had. The second version he calls the Creepy Child version, where you basically have a psychic niece, and I love that version. I think that is so funny and so just freaky. And then the last version in it is called Spectator Cuts Their Future. And this is a version that you actually use the book itself as a main character in the ace cutting routine. And as a matter of fact, I just like this so much. I like the fact that you can only do that version of the trick if you have this book. So I thought, you know what, why not do a demonstration of that trick, which again is the Spectator Cuts Their Future. So here is a performance of Spectator Cuts Their Future. Hi guys, I actually have a brand new book, and this is a magic book, but it's not a magic book like something that teaches you tricks. This is a real magic book. It literally teaches you real magic. And it has a section in here on cartomancy, which is giving readings about the future and the past and the present using cards. And there's one I want to try on you. There's a lot of background knowledge, but I want to try the quad cut fortune telling procedure on you. This says, let's see, with four cuts from a shuffled deck, there are 6,497,400 possible combinations. It took over three centuries to research and categorize each possibility by thousands of readers, blah, 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 blah. And they have put a 12-volume set on how to determine, how to read what the cards actually mean. They have put it online now. So there's a place online for it. So I'm going to do this on you. Oh, by the way, it says that it's proved to be 98% accurate. It's the most accurate type of any kind of fortune telling. So we're going to do that procedure on you, and then I'm going to come back, check the website, and we'll see what it tells me about you, okay? So I'll leave the book there, and we'll do this little fortune telling procedure. So you're just going to take the cards and cut some off, so you can just cut them off like this, about, you know, maybe 15 cards or so. It doesn't have to be a ton, just a small little packet. So the spectator reaches over and they cut off a small little packet, okay? Just like this. And I say, go ahead and do it again. So they cut off another small little packet, let's say here. Okay, actually here, let me fix these a little bit. There we go. And then I ask them to do it again. So they've cut three packets, and then just one final time, I ask them to make one final cut. Boom. So this is the quad cut fortune telling procedure. And then you turn over the top card of each one of these piles. And based on what four cards these are, you are able to give a very, very accurate, 98% accurate reading. You just have to go to the website, which is, wait, no way. Oh my gosh. Out of 6 million, almost 500,000 possible combinations. I want you to look at this. This is crazy. The Transcendental Ideal Layout is the Two of Hearts, Six of Spades, Eight of Diamonds, and the Eight of Hearts. Two of Hearts, Six of Spades, Eight of Diamonds, Eight of Hearts. Let me see what it says about this. On the next page are two sample layouts that represent the pinnacle and the worst of the fortunes. The first, the Transcend Ideal Layout, indicates a life of sustained good fortune and happiness, regardless of the sitter's experiences up to the point of the reading. Wow. So this is literally the perfect outcome you can have, and this is the worst outcome you can have. And I think it's safe to say your day is gonna look up from here. Now that you've seen a performance of Spectator Cuts Their Future, let's go on. Let me just say a couple words about the Spectator Cuts the Future. There's a couple little subtleties in there as well, which I did not do in the video just because it would feel awkward in this setting with a camera. But in real life, I have performed this, and I use the subtleties that are mentioned in the book, and it takes it from kind of creepy to like, whoa, this is freaky, what's going on? So just a neat little idea. The next one in the book is called The Bazillion Dollar Bill Mystery, and it's Andy's take on U.F. Grant's Bill to Impossible Location. U.F. Grant makes two halves of a dollar bill, two halves of $2 bills travel to envelopes, and it's just kind of like, so what? So Andy took this idea and expounded upon it, and one of the bills ends up literally in the most impossible place you can think of. It is really phenomenal. I don't want to get more into the presentation of it because that's what's the real value here, but essentially it seems totally impossible. It's the most impossible bill to impossible location, and it also feels very real. Speaking of real, that's another thing I wanted to say about his presentations in here. He presents things as if he's doing it for real, and I don't mean he presents a color change as if he's really changing the card. I mean his presentations are formed in a way that it sounds like he is telling you what he's doing. So in the instance of this bill trick, for example, he's making the dollar bill disappear, and he genuinely acts like this dollar bill has disappeared, and he genuinely starts looking for it, and then he gets a call from a friend and they have found his bill. So it's that idea. It plays it very straight, very realistic, and yet it's supposed to be unbelievable. He explains it in a way, I'm not nearly as eloquent with my words. If you want to read more about it, go to the blog. But essentially, he has a crazy explanation for how the trick is done, and then they really kind of put themselves in the corner because they're like, well, I know he didn't actually see through my eyes, but how did he know? I really don't know how he knew. And they just kind of buy into this world that you create. The next effect in here is called Talisman, and Talisman is Andy's take on the out of this world effect. It's a pretty basic version of Out of This World, but he does have some really nice convincers that he has thrown in. And honestly, this is probably the best version of Out of This World there is. First of all, it has a purpose. It's not just, let's separate colors. It really does have a purpose. It can almost have a therapeutic purpose, honestly. Basically, the idea is that they find a lucky coin, and then they test the luck of the coin, and it proves to be very, very lucky. And the way that the handling is, it seems super fair, super clean. There's none of the traditional downfalls to a normal Out of This World routine. He's taking care of that. The next routine in the book is called Limitless Ahead, and this is his way of doing a one-ahead routine, but it's crazy and kooky stuff. Like, for instance, one of the examples he gives in the book is he goes into the kitchen, takes a scratch and sniff sticker, puts it on a piece of paper, scratches it, sniffs it, and asks the spectator in the living room what smell they just smelled. So it's that sort of thing. It's very nonsensical. It's not like, tell me a two-digit number. It's fun stuff. It's something that the spectator loves to get involved in. Another suggestion he has in the book is to go outside, get 100 feet distance between the two of you, flash a little business card with a word written on it to them, and then have them tell you what word they think they read from 100 feet away on a little bitty business card written very small. It's fun ideas like that that really elevate this, again, from just having a trick performed on you to being an active member of the trick. The next thing is his section that he calls the revealing thing, and essentially his way of, it's actually kind of talked about more in the next two sections, but it's his way of revealing information in a mind reading routine. The first way he does that is the Passion of Donnie Ackerman, which is, again, a nonsensical, hilarious story about a guy you knew in school who could actually stop time. And then you proceed to show the spectator how you learn from Donnie Ackerman how to stop time, and they get an incredibly realistic sensation of you stopping time. It's weird. They are holding their hand out, and you say in the presentation, you can always feel a tingle when this happens. They write something down, they hold it in their hand, literally time pauses, they feel the tingles that you've described, and you tell them that during the pause of time, you were able to read their thoughts, open up their piece of paper, read their thoughts, and a couple of other things, which just seem impossible. And so literally they close their eyes for what feels like half a second, and when they open, a whole bunch of time has passed. It's really, really fun. I haven't done it yet, but it's definitely one I'm gonna do. Then it goes into the miracle worker, which is another idea he has for presenting like a center tear. And the whole idea behind this is that you basically block every part of your body. You block your sight, every sense that you have. You block it all. You have oven mitts, blindfolds, things up your nose, everything, so that you can, just by tasting the card, you can tell them the information that is written on it. So it's the idea being that if you block all your other senses, then that one sense gets heightened. So again, it's a nonsensical presentation, but they're left going, okay, but really, how did he know, unless he just actually did what he said he did? It's cool. The next presentation of how to reveal something is called Shutter Lock, and this is really, really good. The idea is that you have a group of spectators come up with a noun and an adjective that they write down on a business card. They fold the business card up. Without getting too much into it, you take a picture of everybody. You tell everybody, imagine that object that you're thinking of. So let's say that they're thinking of Harry Pencil. I don't know. Let's just say that they're thinking of Harry Pencil. And you tell everybody, okay, imagine that you're staring at your object standing beside me. And they're, you know, make a face, make it more exaggerated, show me. And then you take a picture of their faces as they imagine staring at this object. And then you're able to tell them what the object is based on that picture. It's really good. And there's a lot of subtleties with this that are so good. It's a way to get multiple information from a business card. It is very good. Next we get into, let's see, I have to skip a couple pages, Dream Weavers. And the idea behind this is you get inside of a spectator's head, you literally get inside of the spectator's dreams, and you cause something to happen in the real world that happened in their dream. Really crazy and very effective. Haven't done it yet, but I want to. It's definitely one that's on my list. Then we get into Andy's thoughts on Equivoke. He calls it third wave Equivoke. It's basically his idea of magician's choice in such a way that it sounds very, very clear about what you're saying. So there's no ambiguity, such as pick this up. Well, does pick this up mean keep it, or does it mean give it to the magician? In his way, he's literally able to say, which do you want to keep? That goes into a little thing called the Yuzhu Gambit, which is kind of dealing with third wave equivoke. It's like the basic idea of third wave equivoke. And then we go to narrow your eyes. And let me make sure, yes, narrow your eyes is his version of the Hoi book test. I'm not gonna get into the presentation, but it is so good. It's the best way to use Hoy's book test, hands down. I've never really been too big of a fan of Hoy's book test. I'm gonna do it after seeing this, and I will do it. Next up, we have the magician's role as moral arbiter. Yeah. Which is, I can't remember what this is, honestly. Ah, yes, okay, that's literally just telling you, sorry, it took me a minute, I had to read because I couldn't remember what that was. That's a little fake section which tells you that this book itself actually does his third wave equivoke. So you could literally hand this book to a spectator and they could go through what's written on the pages and they will end up with an impossible moment where the book sort of merges with reality. It's really, really interesting. And then we get into And Then There Were None, which is a really great idea that he has on a bill trick, where basically you're at a table with five people, you each take out a dollar bill, all of your bills have a strange marking that kind of assemble into a puzzle, like a puzzle piece, and then written on one of the bills is all but one of you must die, decide which one lives. It's, again, nonsensical, but it's very, very fun presentation, and I do want to do it. I don't know if I will, because it's just strange. I don't know if I'll ever be in that situation, but I do want to do it just to see the look on everybody's face. Then we go into cryptophasia, and this may be my favorite routine from the book. He actually presents it as if you're doing table hopping, and then he goes on to say, I didn't do it table hopping, I did it in this and this situation. But honestly, this may be the best way to start a table hopping performance that you could ever do, or just do this one routine, table hopping. Without getting too much into it, basically you act as if you've met your long-lost twin, and then you continually prove that they are your long-lost twin, and it ends with handing them a Polaroid of the two of you in a womb with his name, birthday, and all that stuff on it. It is so good. It's out there. Again, that's his presentation style. It's very out there. But man, it is powerful. And they understand that it's just a joke, and they are supposed to play along, and they do play along. And I'm telling you, they will have something to talk about. They'll have a keepsake that they will actually keep and show people and tell people about this crazy story about how they met their long-lost twin. I don't do restaurant work currently, but if I do or when I do, because that's something I want to get into eventually, I want to open with this routine. I think it's so good. Then we go to Dewey Defeats Truman, which is his thoughts on doing a newspaper prediction. It's basically a way to get around some problems that a lot of people have with newspaper predictions and to make it look like you did something even more than just predict the news, which is really cool. Then we get to Dear Penthouse Forum, and this is in effect it's basically a crude version of Sam the Bellhop, and that's what the magazine that comes with the book is used for, and that's all I need to say. It's a crude and actually hilarious version of Sam the Bellhop. The whole idea is that you're making the story up as you go, and it's so funny, and again, crude and vulgar. I won't do it because I'm not a crude and vulgar person, so it just won't fit my style. But for somebody who does have a crude and vulgar style around friends, oh my gosh, it is hilarious. And it ends with a really powerful moment again that's like, wait, are you saying, whoa, it's really cool. Will you let me into your dream? Ah, yes, will you let me into your dream? Again, sometimes I'm like, what does this title mean? Will you let me into your dream? Is a trick that happens over 4 days, and it's using Uno cards, and a whole bunch of stuff goes on, but essentially you tell somebody about a dream that you had, and then every single part of that dream comes true, and this happens over 4 days. So like the next night you're like, whoa, I had a dream tonight that this happened, and then it comes true, and then that keeps happening over and over again, and you're not ever doing a magic trick, you're just, things are just happening and you've dreamt it. It's really crazy. Reverse psychology is Andy's take on a card force, and it is the best card force you will ever see. You literally, they pick a card, you're able to say, do you want to change your mind? And you show them every card and say, would you like to change that card for any other card in my hand? And they'll say, no, I like this one. This is the one I picked. It's so good. They will leave saying, there's no way he made me pick that card. And that's what you want out of a card force. You want a card force people leave to say, hey, well, I don't know how he did that, but I know he didn't make me pick this card because I chose the one I wanted. Oh my gosh, it's so good, it's so smart. Next we have I Know What You Need, and I Know What You Need is one heck of a routine. Without getting too deep into it, basically you are able to, how do I even describe this? You are able to convince someone, your girlfriend or a friend or whatever, that they wanted something for dinner that they didn't actually want for dinner. That's about the best way I can put it. Essentially, you're able to create a false memory that they wanted something from dinner, and in reality, you made them think they wanted that, and you already have it cooked, and it's sitting in the oven. So good. It uses this app. So when you purchase this book, you actually get an app for free. And this app is one of the best apps you can have. It is so versatile. It does so many different things. You can do memory demonstration. You make people forget things, deal with their memory. You can do forces. You can have someone instant stooge someone else and neither one of them realize they're being instant stooged. There is so much you can do with this app. I love the app and I think it's genius. Okay, that's enough about the app. And that's an effect from the book that actually uses the app. So next we have Hallmark, and Hallmark is a really cute presentation for a card to impossible location, and it really is very clean. He has a way to disappear the pieces after he rips the card up, and the pieces are all in his hand, and he has a really clever way to make those vanish, like literally with nothing. They can see the pieces in the hand, and then the next moment they're gone with no funny moves. It's really, really good. It makes sense. Because you're doing it at a certain time. I'm not going to say too much because it's all about the presentation, but you're doing it at a certain time where it makes sense, and the actions are all, they all have a purpose in the presentation because, well, again, I'm not going to say, but they all actions in that routine have a purpose. Next we go into the multiple universe selection, and this is crazy. This is his most out there routine in this book. Basically, the idea is that you convince someone that they have just jumped to a parallel universe. You talk about how, you know, scientists say that there's literally every outcome that could ever happen is already out there in existence in this universe somewhere. And you convince them that you jumped to a different universe in the moment. It is crazy. I'm not going to get into it. Well, I'll just briefly say you decide to kill somebody. Literally, you decide to kill somebody. You take all these actions to kill this person, like you send them a letter and all kinds, there's all kinds of stuff that goes on, and then you jump to the alternate universe and the letter that the person gets says something entirely different than the one you sent, along with a lot of other things that happen. A lot of things change in the parallel universe. Very fun routine. I don't know if I'll ever do it. If I do, I may just do one or two aspects of it, not go full out like Andy does. But my gosh, again, talk about an experience that somebody will remember and talk about when they say, I don't know how he did it. And I know it sounds crazy, but I literally, like, we went to another universe. Like, I don't know how else to explain it. It's very good. Then we go to Pale Horse and Rider. And this is his idea of how to reveal some information using a Ouija board, but a Ouija board made out of paper and a pen. And it's, I'm not gonna say anything more about that. It's a way to reveal information using a Ouija board made out of paper and pen. Okay, then we have Meta Board. And Meta Board is, again, another one of my favorites from the book. Meta Board is such an engaging presentation. The presentation is, you start off by asking, what would be the least impressive thing that I could predict? And you have a conversation with this person where the two of you are trying to figure out, like, literally, what's the least impressive thing? And then you tell them what the least impressive thing is, and they say, oh yeah, you're right, that is the least impressive thing. And then you say, I'm going to try to amaze you by doing the least impressive prediction in the world. And then you do, and you absolutely hold up to your claim, and at the end, they are blown away by your prediction, and they will react viscerally to the prediction, even though they shouldn't, because they knew what... Anyway, I'm not going to say anymore because they just verified earlier that that wouldn't be impressive, and then they're impressed. It is genius. It really is genius. Then we get into Toxic Shock, which is actually the more out there, the most out there in the book. It's a build to a very impossible location. That's all I'll say. For those of you in the know, you know what I'm talking about. Next up, And Now He Is Me. And Now He Is Me is a really cool trick where you watch a movie with a spectator, and there's a moment in the movie where a magic trick occurs, and then you're like, you know what, let's try that, and you try the magic trick, and then all of a sudden, things go crazy, and you end up with, basically, you become the characters in the movie, and then, like, somebody's trying to kill you, and all this. It's an out there presentation, but it's an out there one that I want to do, and I will do with my girlfriend at some point in time. It's just too fun not to. And then we get into the Mad Libs ploy, and this is another idea where The presentation is essentially that you're going to try to come up with a magic trick on the spot, and the spectator are going to decide what the magic trick is. So they pick some cards out to decide a magic trick, and then you spend hours trying to come up with this trick, and then you look on your table and you've received a letter in the mail, and it literally tells you how to do the trick. You've just spent an hour doing it, and it's a better method. So it's a really fun routine. So it's kind of like a prediction, but it doesn't feel like a prediction at all. Again, you're removing the magician. One of Andy's big things is to remove the magician from the magic moment, and this absolutely does that. The magician is nowhere, he's not even kind of involved in the magic moment. The magic moment is, it's just more like a coincidence, but a really freaky one. And he actually provides a stage version of the Mad Libs ploy, and I have to say, I love it. I won't say I'm going to do it, because that's a commitment that I can't make right now, but I want to do it. It's, of course it's out there, but it's actually really funny, and it's also really sad at the same time. I love the stage presentation. It's a really impressive prediction effect. That's just, it's not just a magic trick. It really seems like something more. Then we get into the baby who knows, which is where you are able to convince a pregnant spectator that their baby is psychic, and literally they can feel the baby answering questions and getting the right number and that sort of thing. And then we have a very unusual camera. This is another one of my favorites from the books that I will be doing with my girlfriend at some point in time. The idea is that you tell your spectator you have your camera on your phone is actually acting up, and it's taking pictures of the future. And they don't believe you, and they're confused, and then you proceed to show them that, no, you're telling the truth. You're literally, your phone is taking pictures of the future, and you prove it multiple times, and it's freaky. It is so freaky, and I want to do it. And then it ends with the epilogue, and the epilogue is the most epic magic trick that Andy has ever done, and probably the most magic trick that has ever been done ever, and it's not even a magic trick. It just shows how far, it really, really shows how far Andy will go to create a magical moment in someone's life. He does it for his friend, a friend that he hadn't seen in a long time, and it truly, like, the most magical moment of her life, and then literally 3 seconds later, all of it's unwraps itself. So she's only fooled for about 3 seconds, but for those 3 seconds, it's the most magical 3 seconds of her lives, and she'll never forget it. I promise she'll never forget it. And that's actually all of the Jerx Volume 1. So that's as much as I can say about it. Again, if you do not know what the Jerx blog is, read it. Now, it's very crude. It's got some words and some topics that are not suited for small children, that is for sure. But it is an interesting read, and you can actually learn a lot from his presentation style. Again, I highly recommend it if you can even find the Jerx Volume 1, because it's super, super limited. If somebody ever sells it, jump on it. Pick the book up, because it's too good to not have. So, that's my review of the Jerx Volume 1, and I hope you have a great day. See you next time.